I'm Mary Ann Sarasso Alioto, and I'm here with Jim LaDuca, and I just want to introduce him. You know, back in the day, he joined his family music business and expanded it, and actually included wines and wine making and distribution. Through his travels to Italy, he's actually gained lots of knowledge that's going to help us as we explore our spring reopening. So, Jim, thank you so much for your time today.
Thanks for asking me to come. That's good. Even though it's snowy out, it is spring.
It is spring.
Yeah, we have been in the wine business now for 40 years, the family, and 80 years in business this November, in total business. So we always were traveling back and forth to Italy, buying and having instruments made in Italy. And then we were selling them to all the music stores in the United States. And my dad, he was the engineering guy, and he would design them for little kids with smaller keys for accordions and organs and pianos and smaller guitars, kind of like the Suzuki method. So that's how we got in the wine business, and now it's pretty much our total business.
That's wonderful.
And we sell our wine after we import it throughout the country in about 20 states. And primarily we're into Italian wines, but we do a big business with California wines and French.
Well, we're here to learn about your Italian wines.
But we're here today to talk about spring wines.
Spring Italian wines.
Spring Italian wines. It's a big deal in Italy in spring because they release their vintages on usually April 1st. And that's when they know how much they have of the prior year's vintage, and they have the pricing and the market. And they release the prices, and you get to taste it, but it's young. So that's what we're gonna do this afternoon, and I'll talk a little bit. I can't
Great.
Stop talking about my business. So
John and I are looking forward to
and
it.
And I have my my nephew here today to help me. He is my brand manager, who will be mixing some of the drinks that we talk about, and I'll introduce him later. And so we should, maybe you'll learn something, and maybe you'll enjoy it.
The occasion today to talk about wine is the Cantina Aperti, which is our theme of this thing, which means the cantina is open, okay? And in Italy, it's been going on since about 1993, and they open up about 100 wineries in Italy. Some say 800, but I don't know how many it really is. The Italians exaggerate sometimes. And it's on a Sunday, and anybody can go to the winery and take a tour and drink the wine. And it coincides with spring, and it coincides with the new vintage that I talked about a little earlier. So that's what we're going to do today. Our cantina is open. The Duca cantina is open. And we're going to talk about our spring wines, which we are just getting in now from 2020 vintage. And we're going to be talking about some. Almost all of them are frizzante. They're sparklers, and sparklers are great for spring because you can drink them straight, you can drink them over ice, you can sip them, and they give you a little sizzle, and most of them are lower in alcohol. That's why we shy away from reds in the summer that are high in alcohol, 12-14%, because they'll knock you out if it's too hot. In fact, at Festa Italiana, when it gets to be those 95, 100 degree days, red wine sales just go right down the tube. So, the first one we're going to talk about, and before I do that, I want to introduce my nephew, Michael LaDuca. He's the fourth generation LaDuca that's working in the company now. And Michael's in charge of the brand LaDuca to make sure it doesn't die and it doesn't go away. And he goes all over the Midwest talking to distributors who we sell to. Who sell Minnesota, Michigan, Ohio, Nebraska.
On and on. All through the Midwest,
Illinois. And he's doing a good job. He's a good guy. Everybody likes him. So the first one we're going to talk about is Prosecco. Okay? Now Prosecco has been around for a long time. And it just recently has become the wine again for the new wine drinkers that never heard of it 40 years ago. But Prosecco is a dry, sparkling white. Okay? And just recently, this year, they're making a pink one.
Yeah.
And it's always a mistake sometimes in my book when they start making a tangerine and a pink and an orange. And I mean, they bastardize the poor really wine that it was. So the Prosecco we bring in is DOC, D-O-C. It's the original controlled by the government one. And it is, looks like that. And
Prosecco, Seco means dry. Like the simple thing, you know, keep it simple. It means dry, it's a sparkling wine. It goes great with, you know, cocktails on its own. Has three atmospheres of pressure. There's all sorts of atmospheres of pressure that you can get up to as champagne's up there and down low as Prosecco, about halfway to champagne. It's the Italian answer to champagne, pretty much, the French champagne. So
ours now is in the category of being considered a spumante. It's a very high quality Prosecco, and we are just getting in the new vintage in a month. We don't have it yet. I'll just tell you a little history. When I was a kid, and my dad would take us to Italy, there was always a glass of something on the table where it was set, kind of the way there is water at our tables when we go in a restaurant, and it was always Prosecco. When you got on the plane for Alitalia, everybody, whatever class you were in, always had a glass of Prosecco. It was called the welcoming drink. So that's what you should use it for this spring. Use it as a welcoming drink. When your guests arrive, don't ask them if they want something to drink. Just give them a glass of Prosecco, and they'll be real happy. So it can be handled straight up. It's got good fizz, and it stays bubbly pretty long. Beautiful. Isn't that nice?
Citrus notes, floral notes, just really pleasant to drink, easy drinking. Just
and
nice.
The head stays on it like beer for pretty long. Yeah. And this is perfect. If you're out cutting the grass and it's 95 degrees, and you really want a glass of wine, what's the alcohol in this?
It is 8.5.
So it's 8.5% instead of 12 or 14. You can drink more of it, and you aren't going to fall asleep behind the lawnmower.
Okay.
The other way they use it in the United States is to make Bellinis. You've all heard of Bellinis? Do you have something to make a Bellini with?
Sure.
And Bellinis is basically Prosecco. Michael should tell you what's in there.
In Italy, you've got Verona, and Verona is where Romeo and Juliet are from. That's where a lot of these spritzes came from. Everyone's drinking spritzes over there, and when the warm weather comes out, everyone's in the square, the piazza, and they're drinking spritzes. And the most popular spritz, I would say, is like a Campari or Aperol spritz, and that all came from the Piazza Erbe, which there is trade routes that go through Italy long, long ago, and they would trade herbs and spices and alpine grapes and all these things, and it got all whirled up into a spritz, which they're served in kind of a traditional glass, and then you just put in your Prosecco and a little Aperol and whatever herb spigot you want to put on there, and then it is ready to drink. And they're nice and peachy and purpley, all different colors. So everyone just has a good time and has a spritz on the...
Can you put some orange?
Patio. Yeah, and you put a little orange in there. So.
I don't need
sure.
If you remember, they were serving this at the last Festa Italiana we had. That was the featured drink. And it went over very well. And it was hot. It was a perfect thing. I would share this all with you, but I'm thirsty. Okay, so I would highly recommend Prosecco if you're looking for a spring wine. It's perfect, and it's very Italian, and it's what they drink in the summer, especially in spring. The next wine I want to talk about is our homegrown brand, Mammertino. Now, Mammertino is a blend of whites. The majority is Chardonnay, but it's made in the method of the frizzante, where they let it ferment in steel tanks, and then it captures the CO2 in the tank, so it doesn't escape, and they put it in the bottle with the fermented, you know, wine and the CO2. And it takes about 21 days to make it. We've had this now for 40 years. This was one of our first wines that we had. And it's still, I would say it's one or two, every month it's a one or two seller. And when it falls in favor in maybe one part of the country, another part discovers it because we introduce it. But this also can be done two ways. One would be the straight up way. Now this was all chilled. I will say this about all of these wines today, they have to be chilled. Even colder than you would think chilled is, keep it in the refrigerator. The colder, the better. They like to be chilled. Now this one is only 9% alcohol, right? 9.5%. You can drink twice as much as this. And this one is not dry like the Prosecco. This is semi-dry or semi-sweet, whatever you want to call it. And it goes in sweet, but I think it ends up dry on your palate, would you say?
Yeah, and the thing about this wine is that it is a family recipe. His dad came up with it, my great uncle, and it's unoaked Chardonnay, Trebbiano, Biancale, all Italian type grapes, beautiful grapes. And it was only really primarily sold in Wisconsin. So everyone, I get a lot of people coming over the border. It's just like, it's made in Italy, small batch, but only sold in Wisconsin. That's kind of unique.
And when we talked to the winemaker the last time he and I were there, he said what even makes it more unique is that the grapes he uses to do the blend, he buys them from certain vineyards to get the right sugar content of each of the blend. So it's always the same. And he said people have tried to copy this and they'll never figure out how to do it. They'll never figure it out. And he filters it and cold shocks it so that it's impervious to the cold weather of Wisconsin. So we can leave this in a truck or a car, and it doesn't make granules of sugar, don't come out. It's very tough. And we've been through 40 years of trial and errors of what went wrong or what went right, and now we have it, I think we have it perfect. It doesn't change color, it doesn't get brown or yellow. And I have had 4-year-old Mamertino, and it still is fine. So we're very proud of this, and we own that name for the whole United States. So we market it on our dime, and it's worth it. No one else can steal it. And now we can make a couple of mixed drinks with this too. Over ice, this works.
Yeah, there's plenty of Mamertino drinks. It's used like a Prosecco. If you want it a little bit sweet, then use Mamertino. Same thing with an Aperol Spritz, just take out the Prosecco. Put in Mamertino. It's not as sweet as Moscato d'Asti. It's not as sweet as a lot of those other syrupy kind of wines that are out there now, because there's a lot of things in cans and in bottles that basically are pure sugar. But this is like a off-dry or semi-dry, semi-sweet. So it's almost like an Italian Riesling when it was created in the long, long time ago for the largely German/Italian around the area. So yeah, use it in place of a Prosecco, a little sweeter.
It works great on over ice, also with ice cubes, and it's great around the patio or a pool. And we sell a lot of it to hotels that use it instead of champagne for the cocktail hour before the wedding reception.
Mimosas.
Yeah. So it's kind of an all-around thing. Plus, at dinner it works. People that don't like 12-14% red wine with their dinner will drink a glass of Mamertino with their lobster. It goes good with fish. It goes good with pizza. Okay. And then we have our number one seller, which is Lambrusco. And Lambrusco has been around for a long time, and our Lambrusco is the way it was originally made in Italy. It's like the competition has orange Lambrusco, lemon Lambrusco. If you go to the Pick and Save, you'll see like 7 Lambruscos, and they're all different flavors. And those are all, they have taken the liberty of adding flavor to Lambrusco, so it isn't the original thing. Now, I'm going to say something about Lambrusco because it's really fun. Lambrusco is not made like regular wine. That's why wine people like put up their nose at it, because they make it from grape juice. They keep the grape juice as juice after it's pressed, like in October. And then they put it in concrete vats that make about 1,500 cases of wine. And it's held at 0 degrees centigrade, so it doesn't ferment. That's the big thing. They don't put sulfur in it to not let it ferment. They just keep it cool. So the refrigeration costs money to keep it cool. And then when Jim LaDuca orders 1,000 cases, they take juice out, pump it upstairs just for the 1,000 cases, and they put it in those autoclaves, and they start heating it up, and it starts to ferment. And 21 days later, it's done. And they watch how much alcohol there is in it, and they know when to stop it. And then they stop it by dropping the temperature real fast. So it takes 21 days to make this. So the one we're getting tomorrow, it was waiting for a boat for a month, but it was made, I would have to say we're April 25th. It was probably made March 2nd. So it's pretty fresh.
Yeah.
And it's meant to be drunk fresh. And you'll see, we bring ours in. Go ahead.
This is a Lambrusco Premium too. A lot of the people in the 80s, 90s, and so on are used to Riuniti and different other big brands that make bulk Lambrusco very cheaply. And ours is a small batch. It's his dad's formula as well. So it's a really dark Grasparosa Lambrusco grape. It's got a champagne cork too, so it's kind of romantic and a little more like a spritz like the other ones. So it's just really dark. It's full bodied. It's not overly sweet and things, so it goes down really well, fruit forward, and then a little dry on the finish. So you can have it with food too, or on its own. You can have it with things like pizza, pasta, lasagna. I get that so much. Oh, I use only your Lambrusco in my pasta sauce, this and that. So it just provides a nice fruit and dark, rich color to the dishes. So just three atmospheres of pressure like a champagne. See how dark, and it's just fun with it. You can put it with fruit, oranges, orange juice, make Italian sangria, limoncello if you want. We were talking about New York sangria, and just nice on its own too, over ice.
Now, what were you talking about with some of the guys are doing in New York? They were adding something?
Yeah, you can do red wines with limoncello because limoncello is an aperitif and after dinner drink, and you just top the Lambrusco with limoncello, and it gives it a little kick and a little tang, you know, a little citrus. So, just a little cocktail, yeah, from New York.
We gotta try that after Mark.
Yeah,
good. Good. Okay, Lambrusco again should be served very cold. It's low in alcohol, as all these are. That tends to be what the summer drink should be, in my opinion, low in alcohol. Because we all know that the heat makes us a little more susceptible to higher alcohol drinks. And the next one I want to talk about is our Moscato di Asti, which is made for us by Massimo Bono, the winemaker. And he has about 20 acres of Moscato vineyards, and him and his wife and his parents and his two kids do it all there. They prune the vines, they plant the vines, they pick the grapes, they make it in their garage. Unless it's bigger than this room, but it's their garage. And I'm the only one he sells to. And so I have his market. And I picked this out of about 30 Moscato makers because this is absolutely the best. And we have switched to a screw cap cork. Finally, the government released us. Everybody has the ability to have a screw cap now because it was having a champagne cork before, and the cork had to be so fat because the pressure was so high on it that it was breaking the bottles to get out. Because it was a regular cork, and to get it out, the people were breaking the top of the bottles off. And it was happening to more than just us, other companies that had the same problem with Moscato di Asti. So now the champagne cork, you can reseal it, and the waitstaff can uncork the bottle without killing themselves.
again, about 3 atmospheres of pressure. It's Moscato d'Asti, where Moscatos you can make anywhere in the world right now. You can put syrups in it, you can put sulfite, nitrate, you can make it cheap, you can do anything you want. It's got no regulation unless it has the DOCG ban, which Moscato naturally grew 3,000 years ago in the Etruscan age in the town of Asti on those hills. That's where this is from. Only a handful of people have the Moscato d'Asti. We're probably one of the smaller makers of Moscato d'Asti out there. So just got really nice natural peach and apricot notes to it. You can have it with salty dishes if you're eating with it, like a butter sage pasta with a little basil on it, or on its own over ice. You can make it with cocktails if you want something a little sweeter. It's not, I get it from everyone, it's not syrupy sweet, it's just nice and pleasantly sweet.
And I always thought, because in Italy, when you're invited to somebody's house on Sunday for dinner, you're supposed to bring them something, flowers, okay, wine, bakery, they bring, after mass, everybody goes invited to somebody's house. And I was doing that when I was a little kid. My mother would say, hey, we got to stop at the bakery, or we got to stop, and we would bring them a bottle of Moscato. And I always thought it went with bakery. That was what I thought. And when I was with Massimo Bono the last time, and it's something I always do, I always ask the winemaker, what do you drink this wine with? What food? You know, and they ought to know because they make it and they drink it all day. And it's like, well, that's a no-brainer. And he pulled out, he said, we're going to go to the restaurant tonight and I will have them make all kinds of assorted things that we drink Moscato with. And every one of them surprised me because there was no bakery. No, he said, never have anything sweet with Moscato. If it's sweet, don't put more sweet because they fight each other. So he had salted ham, prosciutto is perfect. The salt in there with the sugar makes everything work just perfect. So it works good with cold cuts, and I didn't know that. So you can make, in the summer, you can make a bunch of like rolled up prosciutto and melon and have this as the drink. It's perfect. So that's what I learned. And I always learned it. It even happened with, we bring a Sangiovese in the summer and it's made in Rimini. And there they drink Sangiovese ice cold. The fishermen, after they make their catch every day, they come in from the Adriatic with the catch, and most of them have restaurants. Their wife runs a restaurant, and they fish like 3 a.m, and they come in at 7 with the catch of the day, and they'll have them on display in the restaurant. So when you eat there, you don't ask for the menu, you say, what's the catch of the day? And he goes, well, it's over there in the cabinet. You know, you go look for yourself. Oh, well, that's good, what is it? And they got all these names you don't know. But they're drinking Sangiovese, which is red. And they drink it cold with fish. And who's to argue with the people that are drinking it where it's made? So I like to pass those along. And I do the same thing with the wife of the winemaker. Many times they're embarrassed to tell you what they drink it with at home because it's a peasant dish. It might be pasta fagioli, or it might be
polenta.
Some polenta, some thing they ate during the war when they didn't have any money. So they're used to drinking it with that, and then finally you'll get it out of them. And sometimes I let them give me the recipes. So that is, I think, what I want to say about Moscato. And again, ice cold is best. Then now I want to talk about limoncello. Now limoncello isn't wine, but we came out with a limoncello about 2 months ago. And we are having, we fooled around with different blends of how much lemons we should put in. And I watched Mike Pomposano, how he makes it. He came here, we talked about it. And we picked this blend, and it's made by a distillery in Indiana. It's a US made thing. And we licensed them to make it for us with the blend. And it's doing really well. Glorioso sells it. And he actually picked the same one we did when we gave him the choice, because we knew he was going to buy a lot of it. And I think do we put his label on it?
Yeah.
See, a lot of what we sell isn't under our name, it's under somebody else's name. So when the restaurants all were closed for COVID, we suffered because we have a lot of restaurants that we sell to. Now, limoncello is good a lot of ways, okay? This is 20 20 proof, right?
Yep.
20 proof, which is strong enough to be a drink in its own. And it is usually sold in the ready-made drink section.
Yeah, the fastest growing American category of beverages, according to the Nielsen report, is the ready-to-drink category, which can be your like pre-made margaritas and pre-done this, all in a bottle, all in a can. Or we have our limoncello, and we reduced the alcohol, we made it a little bit like wine, we zested it and did a ferment, then we did a second ferment with the juice of the lemon and everything, so it kind of brings more juice to it rather than just kind of knock you on your bottom limoncello in Italy, which is after dinner you have a little bit as like a digestivo, but now you can have it as a drink over ice on its own, mix it in with I get a lot of people buying it for their martinis. You can do it with Italian sangrias. You can do all sorts with it.
But lemons are a big deal in Italy. Everything's got lemons. The bakery has lemons. So the chefs use it for cooking. They put lemon in everything. Are you going to make us a...
Sure.
Yeah. The reason why this is an interesting thing that we came up with is because the history of our company is that we like to redesign the products that are on the market and try to make them better and more interesting. And limoncello is one of them. I mean, we actually got involved with the winemaker, with the blend, and he wrote it down and he doesn't make it for anybody else. And that's kind of the way we did it with instruments, the way we did it with pianos and accordions and guitars. And eventually, some big customer comes to you and says, you know, people are asking for your stuff, so we want to have it. And that's demand pull. But this is our first venture more into spirits, which we actually came out with another one over here. We're not going to talk about it too much, but this one.
Yeah.
Came out with a La Duca bourbon.
Bourbon's a growing category. It took 3 years because it takes a while. You have to pick out your barrels, new charred oak barrels, and then you use your mash. We use 51% sweet corn, locally sourced, and then we use our a little higher rye. But basically, it's a 3-year single barrel bourbon. It's really smooth. I've been told by discount liquors and local guys that do some tasting that it's similar to like a Woodford Reserve. So it's in the shelves now. So. But yeah, we just came out with it. We're doing different things. Got to keep around like everybody.
But you don't have to wait for spring to have it. The soil was here. Okay, so this is what we have here. What do we have?
Limoncello. This is that New York sangria with just a little Lambrusco. You really use Chianti though if you want it a little drier. Use a Chianti Reserva and then just top it with limoncello. A lot of people might disagree, but try it. It's good.
So I guess we could say you could add a little splash of limoncello to any of these to make it your own and to make it even more summery tasting and spring tasting.
Yeah.
Okay, I want to end on a note and talk a little bit about what spring winemaking was to the Italians of Milwaukee that settled in the Third Ward. And my grandpa was one of them. Both grandpas, actually. And everybody had wine presses in their basement. And no wine was available in Milwaukee for them to buy because it wasn't as good as the way they made it in Italy, you know, and they would make their own. So they would buy the grapes on commission roll, which were brought in the railroad car from California, or trucks, probably railroad cars. God knows when they were picked. Could have been 2 weeks before they got arrived here. They would buy them, get them delivered, crush them, make their wine, like in October, November, this usually happened. And they all were doing it. And there was like a little competition. One guy wouldn't tell what his formula was and what he added and all that kind of stuff. And then in my grandpa and grandma, they had this little feud going because my grandma's father had a pasta company with 5 daughters, he was. And she knew how to make everything, right? Don't you know? They knew everything. So when the barrels were fermenting, she would sneak down out from the bedroom and she would throw in her secret little stuff that her father taught her to always put in them and not tell my grandpa. And then my grandpa would walk down there and he would tell my grandma that he added stuff that his father always said he had to put. So it was all this secrecy going on, even between married couples. And then when they would open it. This is the spring part of it. It was always for Easter. At Easter, we would tap the barrel in October that they made the wine to see how it was, because it had fermented all winter. And sometimes it was great, sometimes it was a flop, sometimes it was vinegar. But one brother would compare with the other brother, would compare with the father, who said, no, you had the wrong barrel, you should have bought the grapes from a different guy on Broadway. You know, they were all having, they were pointing the fingers when it was never their fault. But the bottom line is, they didn't have any control over those grapes. Those grapes were picked. I mean, California, when they crush and pick and start putting it into the barrel, it all happens in a day, and they're walking around with their agrometers to measure the sugar content, and none of that happened. So it was hit and miss with our grandpas that they even got wine that worked. But it was theirs, and it was, most of it was awful. But they didn't want to buy, they didn't, couldn't understand why wine in a bottle, you had to buy it in a bottle. Well, thanks for listening to me today, and
thanks for having us. Yeah, the ICC, Italian Community Center, we grew up, each of us, probably generationally as children, like you all did, and we have our little stories about the ICC, and I used to come down there in a van, no seatbelt in the back, holding wine up and make sure it doesn't fall over, drop it off the bat. Just fun stuff, and thanks for having us, coming all this way to see us. It's really nice of you, and we're happy to still be a part, you know, of your community.